morning, everybody. Welcome to Calvary Baptist Church. It's good to hear everybody chatting and smiling. Well, I guess the best to hide the smiles. Yeah. Let's stand together and sing this morning. These two songs should be pretty familiar to you.
Praise to the Lord, the Almighty, the King of creation. Oh, my soul, praise Him, for He is your health and salvation. Come all who hear, now to His temple draw near. Praise Him in gladness.
Brings the human grist and takes it.
found in the Lord of life, who triumphed o'er the grave and rose victorious in the strife for those he came to save. His glories now we see, who died and rose on high.
She played them all, and she enjoyed that. We are doing something a little bit different here today. We're going to have a memorial service. It's somewhat different because of the situation that we're in as far as the pandemic, and we want to minimize the times that we meet, but we also, I believe this is a great learning experience. I grew up in church all of my life, and I was taken to funerals. And I learned early on that death is not to be feared. I learned early on that you invest in eternity. Just this last week, I was watching a show. I don't know if you ever watch these shows, but I watched the show. It was called Epic American Castles. And they have beautiful homes that they build. And one home in particular that stuck out to me was this house that was 20,000 square feet. They needed to pour it all in one pour. This is up in the Hamptons. And the guy that was building it said, I needed 50 trucks of concrete for the day. One supplier couldn't supply 50. They both could do maybe 25, so he locked in both suppliers for 50 trucks of concrete. They started at 6 o'clock in the morning. They were done at 9 o'clock at night, and they made the whole pour, one whole pour. Now, it's a beautiful home. I mean to tell you, more home than I'd ever need. I think we could fit our congregation maybe five times in there. But I want to tell you here today, with all these impressive things, God is at work and he's doing something even more impressive. He's building greater buildings. I think of the Taj Mahal and skyscrapers. They all pale in significance. Pyramids that were built over the years and they're turning to dust. They're concerned about the pyramids, you know, because they're eroding. But all of those things will fail and fade away. But the work of God in hearts is eternal. We're here to celebrate a life in Jesus Christ. The writer Solomon writes in Ecclesiastes, you have set eternity in our hearts. That is, who wouldn't want to live life without turmoil and strife and go on forever in health and strength without care? Wouldn't that be wonderful? Yet life is full of trial and error because of sin. And that's why Psalm 90, Moses writes concerning this. He said, we spend our lives as a tale that is told. And today we're going to tell a tale. We spend our lives as a tale that is told because we fly away after our trials and struggles. What then are we to make of this life and all the trials and struggles that we go through?
Well, the major theme and the major lesson today is that God loves us and he sent Jesus to die for our sins that we might have eternal life. Because of Jesus, better days are ahead. Sickness is gone. Sin is gone. Days when life will abound with love, joy, and peace. And we're like Abraham. As believers in Jesus Christ today, we're like Abraham, who looked for a city whose builder and maker was God. Abraham was a man of faith. We have a picture of a tiny lady. My dad used to say about my mom, oh, it's not the size of the dog in the fight, it's the size of the fight in the dog. And that was my mom. She had a lot of fight. My mom was a very delightful person, even though she was small. She was mighty. I think she was mighty in the Lord. And there's a tendency to get out of balance at funerals. We tend to glorify the individual and not recognize that Christians are sinners, saved by grace. Or we tend to minimize that the things that people have done in their lives, it would be wrong for us maybe to glory in the characteristics of a person. Well, I think there's a balance on both sides. And I think what we need to do is give witness to the fact that if you live your life for the Lord Jesus, there's a reward. Eternity is on the horizon. We want to talk about that today. The gift I want you to notice is some scripture verses today. We're going to look at a few of them. I'm just going to refer to them, and you can look them up maybe later. And naturally, when we put this on the website, you'll be able to have those. We'll have those scripture verses on there for you. The first thing I want you to notice about this eternal life that God gives to us is that we are given eternal life so that we can work for God. Ephesians chapter 2, verses 8 and 9 and 10 says, "For by grace are you saved through faith, that not of yourselves. It's a gift of God, not of works." You know, it's that gift of God. Putting in parentheses, it's God's work. God's gift of eternal life is his work. He's giving it to you. And so he says, it's a gift of God, not of works, lest any man should boast. For we are his workmanship, created in Christ Jesus, unto good works. You know, I've known people all through my life that have gotten saved and not done anything for God. I don't understand that. I believe we love him because he first loved us. He's working in us. And it's the gift of God given to us, eternal life, so that you and I can work for God. Just think, God wants you on his team. Isn't that marvelous? You have some depression today, or you're down in the dumps today. Just think about that. God's called you to serve him, and we can work for God. The gift of eternal life is given so that we can work for God. Secondly, I want you to see the gift of eternal life is given so that we will bring him glory. Ephesians chapter 1, verses 4 through 6 tells us very plainly, just as he chose us in him before the foundation of the world, that we would be holy and blameless before him in love. He selected us to the adoption as sons through Jesus Christ to himself according to the kind intention of his will. And notice verse 6, it says this, to the praise of his glory. God has called you to glorify himself. When you live a godly life for Jesus Christ, you're glorifying God. Thirdly, I want you to notice the gift of eternal life involves my investment. In Matthew chapter 7, one of the earliest songs that I ever learned as a little child, and my mother was my Sunday school teacher. The wise man built his house upon the rock. The wise man built his house upon the rock. The wise man built his house upon the rock, and the rains came tumbling down. The rains came down as the blessings go up. The rains came down as the blessings go up. The rains came down as the blessings go up. So build your house on the Lord. You know, she taught me that as an early little child. That verse says in Matthew 7:24, everyone who hears these words of mine and does them will be like a wise man who built his house on the rock, and the rains fell, and the floods came, and the winds blew and beat on that house, but it did not fall because it had been founded on the rock. You know, I didn't like the part about the sand. I don't want my house falling down. But she taught me about building your life on the rock. Third, I want you to see the gift of eternal life is God's investment in me. He's investing in you and me as a believer in Jesus Christ. Notice what Philippians 1:6 says, for it is God who works in you both to will and to do of his good pleasure. God's at work in you. 1 Thessalonians 5:24 says very plainly, faithful is he who calls you, who also will do it. God is at work in you. Notice number 5, the gift of eternal life is to be demonstrated by me. In 1 Corinthians chapter 11 and verse 1, the Apostle Paul makes a very brash statement to people that are self-absorbed. In today's world, they would take this all wrong. But here's a guy like the Apostle Paul that was self-absorbed. He was into himself and into his religion, and God knocked him down off his high horse and called him to salvation. He surrendered his will. He said, the very first thing he said to God was, Lord, what will you have me to do? And he was willing to go and do it. He surrendered himself. And you notice, he says this in 1 Corinthians 11:1, be followers of me, even as I am a follower of Christ. You know, I think my mom could say that. I hope I could say that. I hope you could say that. When you live for the Lord and you put yourself on one side of the fence and you start living for Christ, there are people that aren't going to want to come along, are there? What's really important is to show that God has given the eternal life to be demonstrated through my life. Ephesians 5:1 says, be imitators of Christ and walk in love as dear children. We had a different experience with the death of my dad with my mom. My dad died abruptly. My mom, we saw the handwriting on the wall for quite some time. And I noticed she wasn't herself. And probably about 5-6 years ago, she kept saying to me, I'm not right. Something's not right. And she started the beginnings of Alzheimer's. My dad, I remember talking to my dad the week he died. I was going through my mom's things. And I mean, 95 and a half years of things, going through those things. There's a myriad of emotions that went through me at that time. First of all, I felt like such a heel, because I was such a rotten teenager. And my mom was gracious to me. I would have killed me. You talk about a godly woman. The fact that she didn't kill me. Until I gave my heart and life to Jesus Christ. You know, my dad used to say, there was a time when we used to, I remember he said this at my ordination, right here from this pulpit. And he was preaching the charge to me as a young pastor starting out in this church. And he said, there was a time when we used to feel responsible for the actions and behavior of our son. Not anymore. He said. Oh, yeah. I was looking through her things. As I went through some of these things, like I said, a myriad of thoughts went through my mind. And I noticed that what came to my mind was Psalm 71:18 that says, even when I am old and gray, do not forsake me, my God, till I declare your power to the next generation, your mighty acts to all who are to come. Now, my mom taught Sunday school class. She took classes, and she knew the Bible inside and out. And there were times when I'd go and I'd visit her, and you know how I like to quote scripture and all that sort of thing, and I'd say to my mom, you know, the Bible says this, and the Bible says that. And she looked at me one day, and she was having a real bad day, and she said, I know all that. She's putting the preacher straight. My mom, and one of the things I'm going to point out later, I want to talk a little bit about the theology of my mom. I learned theology at the foot of my mom. Proverbs 1:8 says, my son, hear the instruction of thy father and forsake not the law. And that word is teaching of your mother. My mother taught me. You know, one of the very first things my mother taught me was to pray. My bedroom was in my dad's office. We didn't have enough rooms. So half of it was his office and half of it was my bedroom. And I didn't have a closet. So as a little child, I had to walk down the hallway and go to my closet. And I was so frustrated because I couldn't see in my closet. There was no light. That's why I love flashlights. I'd use a flashlight to, you know, so she'd come a little bit later on. I'm going to read something to you from her own writing. You pay attention when I read it. But she used to pray with me at night. She'd say, what do you want to pray about? And I said, well, I can't see my clothing in the closet. I need a light in my closet. And so apparently, Mom went to Dad, laid a guilt trip on him. And God used my dad to answer my prayer because he ran a cord from their bedroom up into the closet and I could turn a light on. I could see in the closet. God provided that need through somebody. You know, that's how God provides needs. A lot of us think God has to drop things out of heaven for us, but God really provides it through other people. And it's what I learned to pray because of my mom. Psalm 102 verse 18 says, let this be written for a future generation, that the people not yet created may praise the Lord. Now you're coming here today and you're hearing something that is totally uncommon in your everyday course of life. You're learning, you're hearing what the Word of God says about living a godly life in Christ Jesus. You're not going to hear that when you go to your job, by and large. You're not going to hear that when you go to the grocery store. You're not going to hear that when you go even to see your doctor, unless he's a believing Christian. You're not going to hear that in the average run-of-the-mill thing, but you're going to hear it here today. There's joy in serving Jesus. What was my mom's theology? Well, my mom was industrious. She was constantly cleaning. She did not like clutter. I'm glad to say that because of her, I made my bed every morning. And I used to watch her do a lot of things. When I was 4 years old, I could make my own eggs. I'd watch her cook. I learned to sew by watching my mom. And actually, I got one of the best things in the world because I could sew. I went over to my girlfriend's house, who's sitting right here. This is my girlfriend. And, you know, I have a wife and I have a girlfriend. You know, I got the best of both worlds. But I went over to her house, and her mom was, she had drapes that needed to be hemmed. And she had a sewing machine, and she had arthritis, and it was pretty severe. And it was hard for her to do that. So I said, well, I'll sew them. So I sewed the curtains. Boy, I got in good with the mother-in-law, didn't I? Well, you can chalk that up to my mom. I watched her so many times. She got up at 5:30 in the morning, went to the Botany 500 Pants Factory outside of Philadelphia, and she sewed people's pants. She made children's clothing. She went to York, Pennsylvania, to help provide for the family. She's, you know, a consummate Proverbs 31 woman. She was up early and industrious, and I learned industry from her. She was a dedicated student. You know, if you go back and you look, I saw my report cards. All the comments on there, Jamie would be a good student if he'd apply himself. My mother was constantly challenging me to be a better student. I think she finally got me there. She loved to read. Many a night I'd see her go to bed early. She'd be lying in bed at 8 o'clock and she'd be reading Carl Sandburg's Life of Lincoln, a 6-volume set. She'd be reading War and Peace. You know, she'd read Tale of Two Cities. I mean, these are big books. And then she'd get up at 5:30 in the morning, she'd go to work. She was industrious, she was a dedicated student. My mom was punctual. If anything, her flaw was she was early. She would never be late. If she was late, something was wrong. She was always on time. She realized that people had time constraints. She didn't want to prevail upon people and keep them waiting. She would go early. She was frugal. I remember we didn't have a TV set. We lived in row houses, and the next door neighbors had TVs. And so we'd go over and watch Howdy Doody and shows like that. And my dad would come home and he'd say, where are the kids? Well, they're next door, they're watching Howdy Doody or watching this, Lone Ranger, whatever it was. And he says, well, they shouldn't be over there prevailing. Well, you're too cheap to buy a TV, my mom would say to him. And he'd say, well, I'll tell you what. You find a TV for $75, I'll buy it. At that time, TVs were $100, and he was relatively sure that she wasn't going to find a TV for $75. My mom searched, and she went around, and she found a TV with tax for $75. And she brought that TV home, and that TV had a little screen. I don't think it was more than 9 inches diagonal. And I was the remote control. And then we had an antenna that we put aluminum foil on, and you could adjust it one way or the other. We could get 3 channels. And it was snowing all the time on our TV. But she was frugal. She knew the value of a dollar. I remember, and we kid about this even to this day, I'd go to my mom. I could always buy a donut over at the donut shop one block away. I'd just walk over there, and it was a nickel. And I'd say, Mom, can I have a nickel? She'd say, what do you want a nickel for? I said, Mom, it's only 5 cents. She'd say, 5 cents is 5 cents. What do you want it for? And I said, well, I want to get a donut. Well, you can't have a donut. You buy it out of your own allowance. And I used to get a quarter allowance for the week. And she'd say, and there were things I wanted to buy. And I remember a saying of hers. It was a famous saying. It was from the book of Isaiah. She was always quoting scripture to me. That's probably where I get that from. But she's quoting scripture to me, and she'd say, if I wanted to buy a toy gun, and I'm going to set this up because I have a 10-minute video of her life I want to show you. And there's a picture of little Jamie, and he has a beautiful jacket on. I mean, it has solid brown sleeves, and it's got checkered brown and light tan chest. And we went to the same place where my mom bought the TV set, And we were coming home, and I was all out of sorts because they wouldn't buy me a toy gun. And what she would say to me is, we're not going to buy things for that which is not bread. In other words, you don't spend your money on things that you can't eat. And so I didn't like that answer, and I said, well, I'll show them, and I threw my coat out the window. It was at night, and we got home, and she said, where's your coat? And I said, well, I told you I was going to throw it out the window. I wish I had that little coat. That was pretty cute. You know, you do things when you're a child that are kind of silly, don't you? But she was frugal. She was disciplined in her life. She was an encourager. I remember when we moved to York, Pennsylvania, we moved in January. I was 15 years old, and I had to make all new friends, come to a new school, and I was really depressed and demoralized, and I was a problem. And my mom would come to me every night and say, it's going to get better. It's going to get better. You know, it did get better. I met my wife, and we got married, and now we have four wonderful kids, and they're here with all their kids, and it does get better. She was an encourager. She was sacrificial. There were many times at dinner, she'd take a small portion so that we could wolf down the food. She was understanding. She was forgiving. And I think, you know, there's so many things I could say, but one of the things, and I've told you before, this was a prolonged separation that we had. You know, I knew in February that this was going to go this route and it was going to happen this year. And you know, my mom was resigned. One of the last visits we had in person, it was hard. We'd visit her every day at 3 o'clock at her window. And we requested that we would get in-person visits to touch her and hold her. And the first time I went in, Janice and I had a shield on, we had a mask, and we were in this gown, and we looked like doctors. And I walked in, and I walk over to her, and I lean over, and she looks at me, and she doesn't know who I am. She thinks I'm a medical person. I said, do you know who I am? And she looks up and she said, a doctor? I said, no, I'm your son. And back during Mother's Day, I told you a story when I went off and I'd leave all the time. She'd say, come back here, Jamie, give me goodbye. And we went in and we purposely did that. I wanted to give her goodbye. You know, it's really hard that you have to tell somebody through the window, you have terminal cancer. And this is it, Mom. And the last time we met, I said to her, is this hard for you? And I was expecting her to say, oh, yeah, it is. And she said, no, it's not hard. And I thanked her. I said, thank you for showing me how to live, but not only that, but showing me how to die. Friends, the reality is the most democratic of all experiences in life is dying. Nobody will escape. We're all in line. But I'll tell you what, I've got good news for you. Death is not the end. It's the period at the end of the sentence. And there's a new paragraph of a new book that goes on for all of eternity. Now she's rejoicing in heaven. Lastly, I want to say this about her character traits. She was good at spiritual math. You say, spiritual math? What is that? Well, 2 Peter chapter 1, verses 3 through 9, you read this. His divine power has given us everything we need for a godly life through our knowledge of him who has called us by his own glory and goodness. Through these, he has given us very great and precious promises, so that through them you may participate in the divine nature. You have God's divine nature in you as a believer in Jesus Christ. Having escaped the corruption in the world caused by evil desires, for this very reason, make every effort, now watch this, the terminology, spiritual math, add to your faith. She's speaking, she being dead yet speaks. Add to your faith goodness, and to goodness knowledge, and to knowledge self-control, and to self-control perseverance, and to perseverance godliness, and to godliness mutual affection, and to mutual affection love. For if you possess these qualities in increasing measure, they will keep you from being ineffective, unproductive in your knowledge of our Lord Jesus Christ. But whoever does not have them is nearsighted and blind, forgetting that they have been cleansed from their past sins. She was good at spiritual adding. Add to your faith virtue, and to virtue knowledge, and to knowledge discipline, and self-control. She exhibited that. I remember someone once said, if you were ever arrested for being a Christian, would there be enough evidence to convict you? With my mom, there was plenty of evidence, and I just brought Exhibit A with me. You remember I told you she was getting Alzheimer's? I don't know when it started. It may have been 10 years ago. It may have been 7 years, I don't know, but sometime before that, she realized something was going wrong. This is her personal testimony about how she tried to live her life. And she said, as a Christian, this is what I wanted to do. Number one, I wanted to be happy about going to church, trying to get there on time, which wasn't easy often, especially with three kids. I tried to teach honesty and truthfulness in my children's daily lives at home and at school, which is godliness, godlikeness. When my husband accepted the pastorate of First Baptist Church in Perkasie, Pennsylvania in 1950, a dear lady in the church gave me the best book, Pete and Penny Play and Pray. I used that at bedtime to read a story for each day and pray. It was very helpful because those stories were things that happened to my children, and a godly principle was always incorporated in this story. Number four, extra activities included doing things with children at church and young people's activities. The focal point was our church. Number five, I watched who their friends were. Number six, if language wasn't as it should be, my children were told why and why not speak like that. I emphasized the unequal yoke, that is finding someone that's a believer in Jesus Christ when you get married. Usually, our vacation was spent either going home to Pennsylvania to see our parents and relatives, and we went to church when we were on vacation. We were involved in special services at church wherever we were ministering, in Pennsylvania, New Jersey, Perkasie, York. We witnessed to friends. Vacation Bible school was a highlight of the summer. In those days, VBS was 2 weeks long, and children loved to do crafts, etc. We did some great crafts, and we also, as a family, went to the Poconos for a week vacation. You know, it was the greatest thing. That's the only time I heard my mom yell. My mom, very seldom, she never raised her voice. But she yelled this one morning. I was still in bed, and I heard her just cackling. And here what she had done was she used Bengay to brush her teeth. We had a lot of good times at Poconos, at Peck's Pond. When my dad was pastor in Wildwood, New Jersey, they never went to the beach. But when he went to Percocet, we were always down in North Wildwood. We were at the beach. We'd take a week or two vacation there. There was a wonderful woman that would open her home for us that we could go and spend, and she let us stay there for free. Just being faithful, she says, in my own life for Christ is one of the best ways to develop God consciousness in my children. Lastly, she says, each child is an individual and they must do Bible reading for Sunday school. I remember this so clearly. Saturday night, my dad would take me down to the railroad station. We'd get our shoes shined by a guy that would shine our shoes. You know, when you talk, things don't come out right a lot of times. But I remember we'd go down there, and I was so disappointed when that guy quit doing that, I had to shine my own shoes. You couldn't go to Sunday school without your shoes shined. And then we'd come home, we'd take a bath, and then you get the Sunday school lesson out in your Bible, and you'd fill in the blanks to the questions for the next day's Sunday school lesson. And then we'd go to Sunday school Sunday morning. She was a stickler for that. She says, don't nag whatever you do because you turn them against everything you wish to accomplish. Exhibit A, I have three boxes of other exhibits that I won't take time to go through. I left those at home. There's plenty of evidence for my mother being a Christian. As a young girl, she gave her heart and life to Jesus Christ and wanted to serve him. She could really play the piano. I'd like to show you a little bit about my mom. And I want to show this video now.
Faithfulness, O God, my Father, there is no shadow of turning with Thee. Thou changest not Thy compassions, they fail not. As Thou hast been, Thou forever wilt be. Great is Thy faithfulness, great is when I rise in the morning, when I rise in the morning, when I rise, give me Jesus, give me Jesus, give me Jesus. You can have all this world, give me Jesus. And when I am alone, oh, and when I am alone, and when I am alone, give me Jesus. Give me Jesus. Jesus, you can have all this world, but give me Jesus. And when I come to die, oh, and when I come to die, and when I come to die, give me Jesus. Give me Jesus. Give me Jesus. You can have all this world. You can have all this world. You can have all this world. But give me Jesus.
For time won't pass.
This much I know, I will no longer care. No earthly voice can reach my ear as I climb that golden stair. Now, pen in hand, I'm writing you, this is my last request. Don't grieve for me, don't wish me back, for I am one most blessed. I have a hope beyond the grave, I am secure in God's great love. I leave this world with all its cares for a mansion up above. Though it be hard, please wear a smile. Rejoice and praise our God. 'Tis only this old shell of mine you place beneath the sod. I want to thank you for coming today. It's been a blessing to have a church that embraced my mom. You were a respite for her. And I want to thank you for coming today just to honor her memory and to thank God for her in the Christian life. You know, it's a wonderful thing to be a Christian. It's a good thing to be a Christian. It's the best thing I know. I hope you know him, and you're living for him, and you're looking forward to the day when you're going to join in that great heavenly choir. And those of us that can't sing, you're going to be able to sing then. And we're going to sing on key, and we're going to sing it in timing, and we're going to do a great job. It's going to be good. Thanks for coming today, and God bless you. I want to have one word of prayer with you before we go. Father, we're thankful that we have this treasure in earthen vessels, that the power is not of us, but it's of you. Thank you. thank you for a life lived for Christ. Help us all to aspire to do the same. We pray in Jesus' name.